7:30.
E.T.
Handing Sugar Ray Robinson his first loss as a professional.
Raging Bull. The Right Stuff. What do these films have in common? Either Roger or myself, or maybe both of us, think these are three of the top 10 films of the decade of the 1980s, our subject of this special edition of Siskel and Ebert. I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune.
And I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times. The decade is not quite over yet, but Gene and I are fairly sure of our 10 best films of the 1980s. Maybe another great film will come out, but if it does, we'll redo the show. A movie magazine named Premiere asked us to make individual lists for a compilation that they're doing on the subject, and we thought, hey, that's a good idea. We'll also get a show out of it at the same time. We're going to start out by skipping around the top half of our lists and then report on the full list at the end of the program. And Gene starts with his number five choice.
And that film is Who Framed Roger Rabbit? It's on my list because it was wonderfully entertaining and because I suspect it will signal a revival of interest in animation. In fact, that revival is already taking place. This eye-popping film was refreshingly an adult in its portrayal of the sparks between sultry Jessica Rabbit and Detective Bob Hoskins.
Why don't you do right like some other man?
Just wonderful to see that again. All of my picks for the top 10 are well-made films that also push the boundaries of filmmaking. That's certainly true of Who Framed Roger Rabbit. We hadn't seen animation like this before from a commercial studio, and the time and space-bending quality of the animation mixed with the live action is really a singular achievement by director Robert Zemeckis and animation director Richard Williams. Hoskins was the great human link. The whole picture was wonderful fun, images we hadn't seen before. Who Framed Roger Rabbit is a true treasure in the history of movies.
It's not on my list of the 10 best movies of the 80s, but of course I liked it very much, and I like the idea that you suggested that the great films of a decade might also be the films that try to do something new, something different that hadn't been done before.
Right.
And certainly that three-dimensional quality of Roger Rabbit does that, but my next choice is a film that does something totally different that is also a little bit new. My movie, number five on my list of the decade's 10 best, is a movie that couldn't have been made in the silent movie era, that's for sure, because this movie is almost all talking. It's a strange, courageous, amazingly successful film called My Dinner with Andre, and almost the entire movie consists only of two friends sitting down to dinner and holding a compulsively fascinating conversation. The friends are Andre Gregory and Wallace Shawn, and let's eavesdrop a little bit.
Of course, privately, people are very mixed up about themselves. They don't know what they should be doing with their lives. They're reading all these self-help books.
Oh, God, and I mean, those books are just so touching because they show how desperately curious we all are to know how all the others of us are really getting on in life, even though by performing these roles all the time, we're just hiding the reality of ourselves from everybody else.
Both Andre Gregory and Wallace Shawn find themselves in steady demand as character actors after this movie came out. It was directed by a French filmmaker, Louis Malle, and I think everyone connected with the project saw it as a labor of love. They were probably as surprised as anybody else when My Dinner with Andre turned into a substantial box office success.
Well, the thing that this film pushes, and by the way, it's number four on my top 10 list, so I'm as enthusiastic as you are, is language. Mm-hmm. And remember, we're coming out of, in the 80s, we came out of a decade in the 70s with a lot, at the end, a particularly a lot of action mm-hmm. material.
Images.
People talking to each other with car bumpers and explosions and everything. And here was a film that treasured the spoken word. And it had been a long time since we had it. So this is a very, very important film.
You know what it showed? It showed that films that you might think were too intellectual or too elevated are not at all. That people do have the ability and the curiosity to get interested in movies like this if only they're made, if only they're presented to them.
If there's one thing that we've talked about over the years in criticizing films is when we look on the screen and they're supposed to see real people and we see just talking machines that are saying goofball words that don't have any meaning, any relation to reality, here was some real talk, heightened real talk that was absolutely thrilling. When we come back, more selections from the best films of the 1980s.
Walt Disney Pictures presents a very special motion picture event.
Under the sea! Under the sea!
It's The Little Mermaid, an adventure that'll take you under the sea and beyond your imagination. It's Disney's 28th full-length animated motion picture, and it's only at a theater near you.
Each little clown here, no otter down here, under the sea.
This holiday season, Walt Disney Pictures presents The Little Mermaid, rated G. Starts Friday, November 17th at a theater near you.
Apples have always been tempting, but never as tempting as this. Who could resist chunks of cinnamon sweet apples sitting on a puff of pastry swirled with icing? Apple Sweet Roll from Weight Watchers. Irresistible.
When it comes to bagging garbage, there's a best way.
Hefty, hefty, switch.
And a second best way. A best way to close. A best way to lift. A best way to carry away.
Hefty, hefty, switch.
Why settle for second best?
They laughed when I put my roast in the microwave. Poor Celeste, they said. She doesn't know a microwave's for warming leftovers, not cooking real food. But they didn't know about the MagnaWave Perfection microwave roaster. It's some revolutionary development. And it cooks and browns beef and pork and chicken and stuff perfectly in the microwave. So 35 minutes later, when I put my roast on the table looking perfect, they weren't laughing. I was.
Good evening.
Good night. This is just how I imagined Hollywood to be. Stars putting their handprints in the cement. All the glamour. Well, now it's the Australians' turn. Fosters, preserved for posterity. Posterity can wait. Fosters, it's Australian for beer, mate.
Continuing this special edition of Siskel and Ebert, this is a show looking back on the decade of the 1980s as Gene and I both choose our top 10 films from the past 10 years. And my number four title is Spike Lee's Do the Right Thing. This is a story of a long, hot day in a New York ghetto and of some of the people who live there, and in a way so gradual that we hardly know what's coming, it shows how tension and misunderstanding can build up to violence between blacks and whites. Three of the key characters in the film are an Italian pizzeria owner, played by Danny Aiello, his delivery man, played by the director himself, Spike Lee, and a neighborhood activist, played by Giancarlo Esposito.
We're getting the brothers on the wall here.
You want brothers on the wall? Get your own place. You can do what you want to do. You can put your brothers and uncles and nieces and nephews, your stepfather, stepmother, whoever you want, you see? But this is my pizzeria. American Italians on the wall only.
Do the Right Thing was not a parable or a pep talk, but an attempt to show how little feelings can grow up into big ones and how a race riot can seemingly come out of nowhere. It was a strong, courageous film, one of the few American films in recent years that uncompromisingly tried to say something serious about race relations in our country.
It's an absolutely wonderful film. It's the best film of 1989, clearly. And it makes my list two. I put it in the number six slot, and mm-hmm. I think as time goes on, maybe I might even rank it higher. I've seen it four times. I get great joy out of the filmmaking, in addition to the subject matter, which you talked about quite well. The filmmaking is so much fun that people who didn't go to this picture because they thought it might be too painful for them to watch or some kind of preachy lecture, boy, did they miss an entertaining motion picture. It's one of the best musicals, without dancing only in the very beginning of its title sequence, but it's a musical. Everybody has their own theme song. This guy can make movies. The 1990s are going to be better because this guy's making films.
It was a revelation to me, too, to realize that Spike Lee, whose earlier movies I had enjoyed and admired, is really developing into an important
This is first class. My number four title was My Dinner with Andre. Roger already covered that. Let's move on to number three for me, Philip Kaufman's amazing film of Tom Wolfe's The Right Stuff, about test pilots, astronauts, the cowboy myth, the business of America, and the gee whiz wonder of space itself. The film is very good at showing us the way the gifted Buccaneer pilots are merchandised by the American Space Agency.
My wife's attitude towards this has been the same as it's been all along through my flying. If it's what I want to do, she's behind it. And by golly, my kids are too, 100%.
I don't believe this.
Oh, but look at him out there. They're eating it up.
Uh-huh.
As much as any film of this decade, The Right Stuff was an epic, great American movie, covering on a broad canvas the greatness and sometimes the pettiness that is our nation. The film was not a box office hit in theaters, but it has been a smash on home video, and I just wish more people could have seen it the way I saw it twice, on a big screen with great sound. This is a film that is going to last a long, long time, and I bet it will have a 70-millimeter revival. This is the kind of picture that, you know, they revived Lawrence of Arabia, and this one will have a similar revival, I know it.
You know, it's amazing, because we have not discussed these lists with each other.
No.
How many of the films are on both lists. The Right Stuff is number two on my list.
Okay.
I agree with everything you said about it. The thing that, in fact, I almost want to repeat everything you said about it. If only more people could have seen this, as we did, in 70-millimeter widescreen. This is a movie that really realized the potential of the big screen and what it stands for, and it was so intelligently acted and directed.
The cast
is just a roll call of people who went on to be stars in other
Absolutely.
Movies of the decade.
Just great.
When we come back, more of our choices for the best films of the 80s, including the most popular box office hit of all time.
It's the best thing since sliced bread. New Pepperidge Farm Lifestyle Breads. Moist and rich, but light in calories. A tasty way to help stay in shape for your favorite activities. Mix real fruit filling with flaky croissant pastry, and what do you get? Pepperidge Farm's croissant toaster tarts. What will they think of next?
In life, how you feel about your everyday is often determined simply by how well you treat yourself every day. Moncherie Fine Milk Chocolates, because every day is special.
Calories are tasteless, and they can't really refresh your breath. So could that mean that anyone who chooses a 6.5 calorie Certs over a 1.5 calorie Tic Tac just likes having more calories? I guess so.
I love what you do for me, Toyota. I love how you set me free, Toyota. I love it, love it. I just love it, love it.
Toyota's 1990 4x4. Don't leave the road without it.
Pulses. When doctors were asked what they take more often for their everyday pain, Bayer, Tylenol, Extra Strength Tylenol, or Advil, more doctors take Bayer more than Extra Strength Tylenol or Tylenol more than Advil. More doctors take Bayer. For pain, Bayer is the wonder drug that works wonders.
Continuing this special edition on the top 10 films of the 1980s, Gene's choices and my choices, and a lot of them overlapping, the number three film on my list is the all-time box office bestseller Steven Spielberg's E.T. The movie told the story of a friendship between a typical American suburban boy and an alien from outer space, a strange-looking, wide-eyed, ugly, but somehow cute little alien who sometimes seems like another child and sometimes like a very old and wise adult.
Ouch!
The most remarkable thing about E.T. was how much humor and excitement and emotion Spielberg managed to pack into a movie which must have seemed at the screenplay stage to be merely another special effects picture. A lot of the credit probably goes to those special effects, which made E.T. look not only believable, but even lovable. My prediction is that of all the films on our list, and I don't know your complete list, I'll make this prediction anyway, this is the one that will continue to draw the largest audiences down through the years and the decades to come. Like The Wizard of Oz, it's a timeless classic.
Well, I think that's probably true. It gets the repeat audience of young people, and I'm sure always will. What I liked about it, in addition to the special effects of the creature and then the heartwarming element, was that the film had a very good sense of the way kids talk, mm-hmm. without being gross. It was very acutely observing the suburban world that Spielberg does so well.
It took the fantasy of E.T. and rooted him in the reality of these kids. Was this movie anywhere on your top 10 list?
It would have been about number 13 or 14.
Oh, come on.
Yeah, really.
Really?
Yeah, that's where I had it down. My number two choice, the Holocaust documentary Shoah. And when that film was released, I wrote that this was the greatest use of film because it revived a lost world. Shoah is a 9.5-hour documentary that takes us back 45 years in contemporary interviews with some of the men and women who survived the Nazi death camps and some of the men and women who made them possible. Director Claude Lanzmann doesn't show any of the often-seen vintage death camp footage. Instead, we listen to people tell their horrifying stories, and we don't need anything more than their words to know the shame of it all.
And then one of the couples, they came in and said, "Barbers, you have to do a job to make to believe all those women that came in that they just taking a haircut and going in to take a shower, and from there they go out from this place. But we know already that there is no way going out from this room, because this room is the last place where they went in alive and they will never go out alive again."
Claude Lanzmann reveals the dark side of human nature better than any horror film I've ever seen. He also corrects a lot of lies that have persisted for years about weak-willed Jews, about neighbors not knowing about the nearby death camps. Millions died, we learn in this film, because a lot of people wanted them dead, because the rest of the world didn't care enough to keep them alive. What an achievement Shoah is.
I agree with you that this is one of the greatest uses of film that I've ever seen. It's not on my top 10 list for a very strange reason. If you remember the year this movie came out, it wasn't on my top 10 list that year either. And what I did was I said I put it in a separate category. It didn't seem to me that a 9.5-hour documentary of this importance and this scope belonged on the same list with two-hour entertainment movies and feature films that are going to be playing down at the corner on Friday night. It seemed to me to be a different, not only use of film, but kind of film. And I still feel that way, that it doesn't seem to me to belong in the same continuum of these other films we're talking about. It's a different sort of thing.
It's that great, you're saying.
It's that great, it's that important, that somehow it just belongs in a different category.
At home, when you can study this film, and it can be quite intimate, and you can have your own personal relationship with this movie.
And take a break occasionally.
It's extraordinary.
Coming up next, our choices for the best film of the 1980s.
Splish, splash, wash my hair in a dash. Right before my Saturday date. What a pain, got a clog in my drain. Grab my Drano, hey, blue, smells great.
Liquid Drano clears and deodorizes.
Señores y señoritas, fajitas. New from Weight Watchers.
Qué bueno!
Introducing Pepperidge Farm's new snack. Snack, 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 snack mix. With so many tantalizing tastes, it's seven different kinds of delicious.
How to spot a Pepperidge Farm distinctive cookie. Dark chocolate hidden between delicate vanilla wafers is Milano. But soon as you see one, it disappears.
Occasionally, through the sands of time, there emerge designs which are viewed as more than evolutionary. Introducing the revolutionary 1990 Toyota Celica.
we did the 500th broadcast of this show, I mentioned that my favorite film of the last 14 years since Roger and I began doing this show was Raging Bull. Obviously, it is also my favorite film of this decade. Martin Scorsese's Raging Bull is, of course, the Jake LaMotta story, the boxing story with Robert De Niro playing a human animal.
LaMotta is taking terrible punishment on the ropes as Lucille bangs him his left and right to the head. Another left, another right to the jaw. And LaMotta turns around. He's been playing possum. He's got Lucille hurt. He ripped the right hand of the body to the left to the jaw. Another left and a right to the head. Lucille is flailing around the ring. The tide has turned, no question about it.
Shot in beautiful black and white, Raging Bull reaffirms Scorsese as the preeminent filmmaker of our generation. He's using all of his techniques in this picture while still telling us a great street story, finding life among the lowlife.
The first film on my list for 1980s is exactly the same film, Martin Scorsese's Raging Bull, and there was no question in my mind. I think that's kind of amazing that we would be in agreement on that, but of the films that I saw in the last 10 years, this is the one that went out there on a high wire, and it never looked down, and it kept right on going. This is the one where the director was really swinging for the bleachers. And also, of course, I think it has the best performance of the last 10 years in this remarkable work by Robert De Niro. From beginning to end, Raging Bull is an amazing motion picture.
When I think of that picture, I don't think, oddly enough, of the boxing sequences first. I think of some of those, that lazy, like, weekend afternoon when Jake goes over to try and pick up Vicky at the pool. And I look at those beautiful images, and I think that there's a lot of dreams there. There's something in the colors. It's almost like silky sheets, the white, the color. It's just such a beautiful piece of filmmaking.
It's a film about an entire life. It's a film about the spaces in between the high points. It's a film about the end of that life, when Jake LaMotta is running a nightclub down in Florida, and he's out of shape, and he's kind of a figure of jest now, instead of being that person who, for a second there, was great. And it's also about the obsessions that he allows to destroy his life, the jealousy, the insecurity. Mm-hmm. By the end of that movie, you really feel you know that person.
There isn't anything more I need to know about Jake LaMotta than I got in that film. What an achievement that is.
It's a great film. What we haven't done yet on this show is provide a complete rundown of all 10 of the titles on each of our lists. So here's my list of the best films of the 1980s. Number 10, House of Games, the strange and hypnotic David Mamet film about a psychologist who wanted to know all about Conmen and found out a lot more than she really wanted to know. Number 9, Platoon, Oliver Stone's harrowing film about the daily lives of infantrymen in Vietnam. More than any other Vietnam film, it reproduced the experience of actually being under fire and under incredible pressure in combat. Number 8, Mississippi Burning, which recreated an era of recent American history when segregation was still the law. The movie contained one of the great performances of the decade by Gene Hackman as an FBI man. Number 7, Ran, a magnificent epic by the great Japanese director Akira Kurosawa, based on Shakespeare's King Lear and classic samurai legends. Number 6 on my list, Steven Spielberg's Raiders of the Lost Ark, one of the greatest adventure movies ever made and influential throughout the decade. I've already discussed the top 5 titles on my list. Once again, they were Louis Malle's My Dinner with Andre, Spike Lee's Do the Right Thing, Steven Spielberg's E.T., Philip Kaufman's The Right Stuff, and number 1, Martin Scorsese's Raging Bull.
I have a couple of reactions to your list. Do you think Mississippi Burning will last in the way that some of these other pictures will last?
I would defend Mississippi Burning in the same way that you were describing Shoah. This is a movie that people need to see in order to know that this time existed and that people had these feelings. It is a part of American history that young kids today really don't know about, even though it was only 25 years ago, and I think it's important for that reason.
Yeah, I don't think it's as factual, and of course there was a lot of talk about that at the time.
It's factual about its feelings.
It's factual,
and that's the most important thing to be factual about.
It's factual about it's the hate that was present in the air, that's for sure. The other thing, no comedies as such. How do you react to that? Tootsie could have been on the list. It almost made mine.
It wasn't on my list. I don't know. I just looked. What I did was I took the 10 best list of every year for the last 10 years, so I had 100 films to choose from, and started taking them out until I came up with this 10. So I didn't do it from the other point of view, which comedy, which drama to choose. I did it.
You know, but Woody Allen makes the point that comedies aren't as important as serious films.
If there was a film that would have made my top 10 list, it would have been his Hannah and Her Sisters. But the question is, to what degree is that really a comedy?
Okay, now let's take a look at my choices of the best films of the 1980s. Number 10, Akira Kurosawa's Kagamusha, The Shadow Warrior, a revisionist look at the samurai legend. Number 9, Stephen Frears' Sid and Nancy, the punk rock tragedy, the best of the drug films for a drug-influenced decade. Number 8, Jerzy Skolimowski's Moonlighting. It's not the TV show. No, this was the epic film about workers and masters told on a small scale during the rehabbing of a London townhouse. Number 7, Sergio Leone's Once Upon a Time in America. The long version, of course, of that film, not the chopped-up one that was originally released. It's an epic film of the immigrant experience of the dream twisted through corruption. Number 6, Spike Lee's Do the Right Thing, the gloriously filmed racial drama. Number 5, Who Framed Roger Rabbit? 4, My Dinner with Andre. 3, The Right Stuff. 2, Shoah. And number 1, Raging Bull.
You know, looking at your list, there were two films that almost made my list, and they were Kagamusha by Kurosawa, but then I went with Ran instead, which I think is a better film, and Sid and Nancy, which I think was really overlooked in a way, mm-hmm. but had such great performances and was such a strong portrait of those lives.
Do you know that on Sid and Nancy, when I looked back, it didn't make my top 10 in that year? And now I'm putting in the top 10 of the decade because I realized just how strong that film, it was close to making my top 10 list, but now that film has just grown and grown, and I think you're trying, you know, this is the drug decade, or has been the drug decade, and boy, that film is strong about it.
One thing that happened to me, I have a list of every top ten list I've made since I became a movie critic, right? Hundreds of films here. So I went back and I looked at the films of the 70s as well, and you know what I found? In the 70s, the best films, generally speaking, were foreign films. Mm-hmm. That was a decade when the great directors like Fellini and Bergman and Truffaut and Romer were still not only active, but were coming up every year with some of their best work. And then in the 1980s, foreign films seemed to drop out of the picture more. And it's more Hollywood films, more commercial films.
Well,
the years of the 80s were not as good as the years of the 70s in terms of films.
Well, but America has steamrolled the whole movie industry. That's well known. We're obliterating the film cultures of the other countries. And now, some of them, these are good films. We're talking about the good stuff now, but of course, it's happened in just commercial product as well.
That's it for this week. Next time, we'll be back with reviews of new movies. And until then, the balcony is closed.
Nestle Crunch. It's creamy milk chocolate and crispy crunchies. Chocolate is scrunchious when it crunches. That's why you'll love Nestle Crunch. Rice-A-Roni, the San Francisco treat. Now with 30 flavors, you can serve it every day for a month and never serve the same dish twice. Special Dinners brand cat food now offers two great-tasting varieties in one economical 3-pound easy-to-carry twin pack. Special cats like yours deserve the special taste of Special Dinners. Stetson Cologne, the great masculine scent that's easy to wear and hard for a woman to resist. Stetson fits.
This year, record numbers of people will look for a home in the paper. Sadly, many will find one. United Way, together, we can make a difference.
Every once in a while, a lower-calorie product comes along that actually tastes good. Cane's Light. Half the calories, all the taste.
Citibank has an 800 number for the hearing impaired, so they can call us on special teletype phones. I read what happened and typed back that I'd cancel her old Citibank Visa and send her a new one right away.
Not just Visa, Citibank Visa.
Kind of family affair.
Is it not true that you and your stepmother...
Yes.
A suspenseful all-new episode, Perry Mason, Case of the All-Star Assassin.
Sunday, the events in Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union and renewed fighting in Central America. Among the guests, foreign policy experts Zbigniew Brzezinski on Meet the Press.
In the 80s, Honda was known for the highest mileage. But today, the 90s begin with the new Geo Metro. Metro XFI is the highest mileage car in America. It's also one of the lowest priced cars in America. So it's very easy to get to know Geo Metro. It's just around the corner at your Chevrolet Geo dealers.
Children and adults nationwide are missing. Paintings, videotapes, collector's items, all have been lost or stolen. Huge cash rewards are being offered for their return. You can help. Join Stacy Keach for Missing Reward, and the rewards can be yours.
Saturday at 7:30 on TV4.
Families have gotten smaller in the 80s, but some still find that bigger is better.
I think the key to success with the 9 children is order. Order is survival.
Why are some people bucking the trend? I'm Casey Kaufman. The ups and downs of life in a large family on the next Women Today, Monday at 5:30, live on 4.
One-on-one, Mondays at 6 on WBZ TV4.